So the panel is complete, so let me start slowly but surely. If we can keep the noise in the room to the minimum, it would be nice, but I expect people coming inside, so there will be some nuisance. Firstly, let me welcome you at this panel dealing with the Eurozone and Greece. And the overall prospect of the Eurozone integration and of the Eurozone survival in the next years. Until basically 2013, the Eurozone crisis was the biggest crisis that the European Union has been handling. Since then, we had other concurrent crises, and today we would say that it has somehow superseded. But to be honest, we see the situation, for example, in Italian banks, that is a direct result of the crisis and is most probably also a direct result of the architecture of the Eurozone that is to a large extent non-complete or not exactly or not perfectly fit for the purposes and for the challenges of a common currency on such a great geographical level. So. There will be some issues. There will be the Eurozone crisis will probably be again on our agendas, either because the migration crisis will fade down, or because some other and real problems, such as those with the financial sector, or the effective implementation of the banking union, will for certain be on our agendas in the next years. So it's not something completely solved. You know that in June 2015, there was a report on the future of the Eurozone, of the EMU, edited by five presidents, a team led by Jean-Claude Juncker, but with in close cooperation with Gerund Dijsselbloem, with Mr. Tusk, with Martin Schulz, and with Mario Draghi. And we know that in this report there is a kind of a clear roadmap. Well, clear is maybe an euphemism, but it is a roadmap towards an integration from today to 2025, when the institutions of the Eurozone should be, let's say, fit for future crises. Just one small remark on this dynamic, because we know that we have other topics to deal with. When the president's report, five presidents' report, was published, almost immediately the migration crisis has completely overshadowed it. That was one of the reasons why the report itself was discussed, or let's say dismissed, during the European Council by one sentence in the final statement, in the conclusions. But it is still here. And not just this document, but the overall integration process. It is continuing, and let me compare it to one biological phenomenon that I have not confirmed and I have not researched, but just heard about, that actually elephants are not afraid of mice because they don't see mice. Mice move too fast, and elephants have actually a different brainwave capacity. They don't see, cannot really detect a mouse. And on the other side, the mouse has also a much quicker way of thinking and of behavior, and all its metabolism is much quicker. An elephant is actually moving too slowly for the mouse to be a relevant object. It is somewhere between a very slowly moving animal or a tree. And we are the mice now in our daily political business, and we don't see the elephant, which is the overall movement, the overall dynamic, either of the Eurozone or of the European Union, but it is still happening somewhere. And we will not be able to read it through in the final statements and in conclusions of the summits, but there is a movement towards a kind of different Eurozone, and certainly it will continue. And one day we can realize that actually the elephant has moved without us really being able to witness this. So this is just a general remark and something that I would like to be remembered during the presentations. Second remark is on the case of Greece. We know that we have Greece here in the name of the panel, but I would not really recommend to deal only with Greece. We deal with general issues. We have the Greek ambassador to the Czech Republic here that will certainly give us some perspective on this country. But it is clear, I think crystal clear, that the problems that Greece has encountered are not Greece's problem, just Greece's problem. Those are problems of the whole Eurozone. Those are problems of many other countries. The symptoms of what was happening in Greece was of course, very salient and very important. But at the same time, we might encounter very similar crises and very similar problems in the future. And we have encountered them in other countries. Not to forget also the fact that Greece in the 1980s, together with Spain and Portugal, was in the same situation as us today, almost, in terms of the access to the internal market, in terms of fighting to be an equal member within the EU, in terms of coping with the cohesion policy and implementing it. To a big extent, we are in similar positions, and once we all enter the Eurozone, we can find ourselves also in similar positions. Not that we would be going towards a crisis, that's something that I didn't really want to mention, but that if the structural problems of the Eurozone are not solved, it is difficult to imagine also our, let's say, Central and Eastern European region to be fully implemented without any problems into the structures of the Eurozone. So this is for the introduction. I will leave the panelists to introduce themselves on their own, but more deeply. But I will still go through the order of how they will present their presentations. So firstly, we will hear is Zdeněk Kudrna, who is a researcher at the Salzburg Center of European Union Studies, and who is a long-term student of the dynamics of the European Union, both from an economic and political perspective. Then we will hear a presentation of the chief economist of the Raiffeisen Bank, Helena Horská, on my right. And afterwards, I will gather some input from His Majesty. His Majesty, it's Excellence. Sorry, I'm confused with the titles. From His Excellence, Mr. Ambassador. Majesty is just one, I suppose. Not so many. And afterwards, we will hear comments, more of a political comments on what will be said. Firstly, from Ilya Lingorsky, who is now a president of the Bulgarian section of the European League of Economic Cooperation, but has a long history in working for the state institutions and forging policy making arena in Bulgaria. And afterwards, we will hear a final presentation or final contribution from Christian Sabados, who is a chief executive officer of Political Capital Institute in Hungary. So, with not much ado, because there was a lot of ado from my side until now, I give the word to Zdeněk.
All right. Good afternoon. Next one. Okay. So what I thought I would start this panel with is some kind of little structuring of or a little recap of where the euro crisis is standing, because it's off our radars, being replaced by all the other crises, primarily the migration one right now. So as has been already mentioned here, the architecture of the single currency is still incomplete, and there is a blueprint for its completion, finishing the economic, banking, fiscal, and political unions. At the same time, the euro is also stable, and that we have seen that for last year, once the Greek show-off last summer was over, we haven't heard much of the about the stability of the currency, which is a good news. However, we also know that since the architecture is incomplete, this stability is only temporary. It's not based on a long-term sustainable basis, which means that the single currency also remains fragile, and that expected and unexpected events can derail its stability. So in this context, we can sort of look at potential scenarios of what may be happening, or think about how to think about the short-term future of the euro, and a productive way might be looking at the north-south political economic game under the uncertainty, by which I mean that a lot about the euro future, about completion or another bound of instability, depends on the relationship between the creditor states and the debtor states. Plus, there is a lot of room for surprises. So now the dominant strategy for the Eurozone reforms so far has been what is called muddling through, which means extremely gradual reforms when always the minimal necessary amount of reform is delivered at the last moment. So if in summer 2012, there was a real risk of euro collapse, the banking union in its minimalist form has been delivered. The same goes for all the ECB policies that essentially buy time for the substantive reform of the Eurozone, but the monetary policy on its own cannot really put the single currency on the sustainable basis. So we know this list of what has happened, and the consequence of this temporary stabilization is what one might call the asymmetric adjustment. It's the austerity for primarily the southern countries, the debtor countries in the Eurozone, and in the northern countries also some kind of austerity, but in this case it means primarily non-expansion. And it's asymmetric because if in a fully functioning single currency system, you would see that if the south experience austerity, the north should act counter-cyclically, which in this case means to expand. Nonetheless, even under this asymmetric system, since the fears of a breakup were suspended, there are the usual economic mechanisms that help rebalancing between these two parts of the Eurozone. That's something that economists called real economic exchange rate, which basically means that the firms and the capital move gradually to places where it's cheaper, which in this case is getting in the southern austerity-stricken countries, and therefore their economies start to pick up gradually. There are also some other good news on the side, such as lower energy prices or a relatively cheap exchange rate of the euro vis-à-vis the major trading currencies that also help. So this is a fully sustainable strategy, and if one looks into the EU history, how most problems have been solved, the muddling through seems to be the dominant way of approaching anything. It's actually not such a bad idea, because if there is a lot of uncertainty, the more radical reform designs, they can actually backfire much more than the careful and gradualist approach. But at the same time, there is a price to pay. Muddling through doesn't come cheap, and in this case, it means lost decade, probably, hopefully not more, for some member states, especially on the southern periphery of the Eurozone. So this is not the only challenge the muddling through scenario is experiencing. There is still a potentiality, although after so many years of not seeing it, we can still get to the point where the austerity gets rejected by the southern electorates or the southern governments. And it has been said already here at this conference that the Greek exit or exit of one country from the Eurozone would not be such a disastrous scenario. It's probably true that it's much less risky than 3 years ago. But at the same time, I don't really believe in our capacity to predict and estimate what the likely consequences might be, because we might be quite okay on the economic side of such a scenario. But the legal and political risks, they are essentially unpredictable, and because they are unpredictable, they are very difficult to contain. So there are no rules for redenomination of the single currency-based contracts, for example, but if one country leaves out of the Eurozone, you have to be able to redenominate these contracts, and if you do it in the currency of the remaining Eurozone states or the one that that has left, there might be 40-60% difference on every single contract. So I'm just throwing this at you as an example of the kind of legal risks for which there is no solution. I mean, it would have to go through the courts. How long would it take? Probably decades, as far as we know, how these complex international disputes evolve. So the bottom line is that because of the political risks and because of the legal risk, any kind of euro exit is a still massive shock to the global economy and has a potential to become the Lehman number two event, i.e. trigger of the global financial crisis. So this is the capacity on the side of the southern European politics to derail this muddling through scenario. On the northern side, we could hope for some better news, because essentially if the northern voters, and now we are talking about Germans, Austrians, Dutch, and a bunch of others, if they agreed to pursue, well, just merely a macroeconomic expansion in their own economies, that would help to suck in more imports from the Eurozone south. It would help, but the real political challenges, the real hurdles, is about the acceptance of some element of fiscal union or some transfer union, which could be the Greek debt restructuring. No, the Greeks were promised this already in 2012. There were two deadlines, and always this just gets postponed after the next elections, after the next elections, after the next elections. So if the electorates and the governments of the northern countries would be ready to do proper debt restructuring, that would be a major step forward. The same goes for finishing the banking union, which still is without the proper fiscal backstop, which is still without the proper deposit insurance. And there are plenty of ideas how to do the next step towards more complete architecture, institutional architecture for the single currency. So it can be some kind of cyclical adjustment fund or common unemployment insurance, or then the widely sort of differing scenarios for euro bills, euro bonds, or euro treasury. Any of these measures, as long as they provide the missing institutions for the single currency and provide some relief of austerity in the southern economies, would be welcome. However, you know, we've seen this this political debate for now over 6 years, and nothing had happened. So this only shows that unless there is some positive move in the northern political economies, then the Eurozone is still kept at this vulnerable place, and there is the risk that obviously the populist parties can also disrupt by doing the exact opposite of one would of something that one would have hoped for, like the scenarios on this slide. Last but not least, we need to bear in mind that next slide. Yeah. We live in the times that are essentially highly uncertain, which is just economics terms for what Donald Rumsfeld told us about the known unknowns and unknown unknowns, that the stability and the capacity of the institutions that have evolved since the Second World War to balance any kind of crisis is probably getting stretched to its limits. And therefore, any kind of shock, which following Taleb we now call black or white swans, can turn this fragile temporary balance of the Eurozone into next bout of hot crisis. The trouble is, saying or imagining these black or white swans and also interpreting them, because any shock can act in a good way or in a bad way. I mean, the assertive Russia on the European borders is probably bad news for geopolitics, but we shouldn't forget that much of the European integration was also construed against something, against the during the Cold War, against the Eastern power. So whether this threat brings Europeans together and enables them to make the difficult political decisions to complete the architecture of the single currency or not, that's anybody's guess, and that's why it's so uncertain, and that's why we have to be so wary of any of these low probability but high impact events happening. So nonetheless, we already have a sort of time series. We have an experience of a few years, and we can guess that the muddling through is the most likely scenario. We can expect that the most minimalist reform responses will be probably delivered at the last possible moment. And therefore, we have to hope that this extremely gradualist way of reforming and stabilizing the single currency won't be disrupted by one of the shocks, be them political, geopolitical, or indeed economic. So I hope this is just by way of entree into our discussion, highlighting that the debate has two sides, that it's between the northern countries and the southern countries, and each one of them have potential to make major improvements, but also to derail the fragile stability.
Thanks. Thank you, Zdeněk. I think it was a really large and exhaustive way of seeing our future, so thank you for this. I would like to underline just one aspect that you mentioned in the beginning, and that's the asymmetry of the adjustment that we've seen in the last 6 years. When you look at the net borrowing and net lending external in the south and in the north, you see that there was effectively an adjustment in the south due to the recession, due to the lower internal demand, also maybe due to the increase in competitiveness to some degree, but there was really very, very little adjustment in the former surplus countries that tend to remain surplus countries, and they are taking the surplus countries from formerly neutral countries such as France, and we might be actually heading in the long term into a very similar situation that we had in 2009, 2010, when these imbalances actually started. So without dealing with this, I don't see really a bright future for the Eurozone. Now, let me give word to Helena Horská, who will talk more specifically on Greece, but with larger implications also for the Eurozone. Thank you.
So, thank you, first of all, for inviting me for this panel, and I'm very happy to be here and to discuss not only the political issues, which I think are very important, but also the economic issues, because in my view, and I'm not agree with the, would say, the previous panelist, and the second one, that the problem with the Greece is just the economical one, because I think this is the more or less the problem political in politics, not so in some extent of economics as such. But to be more concrete, I will start to give you some idea about what is going on in Greece, and I think that you may know some the information and steps that were done during the last couple of years. So the first thing what I would like to stress here is that the Greece is not the most indebted country. We should stress that the public debt in some countries is even higher than is in Greece. But what's the problem with the Greece is the unsustainability of the debt development, which means the dynamics of the debt, and also the problem which is inside the economy, the politics, and the economy. as such. The economic problem, I would say the Greek illness, is very well known. We made start, would say, with a very low fiscal discipline, but also with a less effective economy, including the big share of the state in the economy, not very well liberalized sectors, also with a very, would say, a very expensive social system, including the pension system, and we can go on with this list of the Greek illness. But as you can see, it's not the problem, and these problems are seen in other countries, in Portugal, in Italy, in Spain, and we used in economy, and the economic policy used the term the PIGS country. All these countries have the similar problem, but I would say the only the Greece was under big and very tough financial market stress. The problem, in my view, is that lots of economists change the view that under the pressure of economic development in Greece and also especially on the political scene, they change the view that the Greece should not adopt the euro. So there are lots of economists. It was at the beginning Krugman or Stiglitz or even the other one that say the euro is not good for Greece. And we have more and more economists now that are saying that the Greece, or would say the first best solution, was not to adopt the euro. But the euro is here in Greece and we have to find the second best solution to find a way how to do and how to solve the Greece crisis with so at least harmful way. In my view, what we can help and how we can help as an economist to politician is to try to identify the least harmful ways how to go out of the darkness. This is our position, but our position as an economist is not to adopt the changes. The changes are in the hand of politicians, not in the hand of economists. This is what I would like to stress here as well. Here you can see the time schedule or the timeline, what would say only the key milestones that happen in Greece. And you can see that last year, in 2015, was a turbulent year. There was two elections. There was very fast change and turbulent development on the political side. There was different politicians, different view on solution of Greek crisis. And also we had the second part, or would say the Greece were pressed to adopt the third bailout program, despite the fact that in January 2015, the politician in Greece promised that they will not adopt another bailout program, another fiscal austerity. The results and the reality was very different. So you know, and we know that development in Greece is not very favorable. We know that the situation of people in Greece is not, would say, very nice and polite. But the way how to solve the problem is, would say, to change not only the way how to solve the problem with the financial and fiscal situation, but also to look on the new ways to get the Greece from the darkness. The idea that were developed last year was the idea of parallel currency, or as I mentioned, so-called the Brexit. The question is if the Brexit or the parallel currency would solve the problem of Greece. We try to make some estimations. Of course, it's hard to find the data and hard to estimate something theoretical, even from the historical point of view and from historical data. Unfortunately, our conclusion is that the Brexit, so the adoption of the new drachma, would not solve the problem of the Greece. Why? Because you can thinking about the extent that would need to be adopted, or the extent of the devaluation of the currency that should need to restore the competitiveness of the Greek economy. There were some discussion that a new currency needs to depreciate by 30 or 50%, but it seems to be not enough. Because if you remember the South Asia crisis, these currencies in South Korea, in other countries, even weakened by more than 90%. So even the 100% devaluation may be not enough for Greek economy to rebuild the competitiveness and to rebuild the health of the country. So what is a solution, in my view, is to combine, would say, not only as we can see the restriction on a fiscal side, but just stress the so-called the internal devaluation measures, which means to decrease the production cost, improve the structure of the economy, limit the restriction of some sectors that are still valid. Also to focus not only on fiscal expenditures, but also to look at the fiscal income. Because as we know from the experience from Latvia, Latvia did the same fiscal restriction in a very fast way. During 2 years, they were able to cut the fiscal deficit. In a significant way, they cut the expenditures in the same way how was the plan with the first and the second bailout program for Greece, and the result was very fast recovery of Latvian economy, very good reshuffling of the economy, and rebuild of competitiveness of the country. So I think the way, and this is exactly what I'm saying, I'm not a politician, I'm economist. And in my view, I say, hey, guy, look what the possibility, what is good for Greece economy. And in my way is to combine and focus on internal devaluation and focus on rebuild the competitiveness of the country with, by reducing the cost, making some sectors more liberalized, privatized some sectors that we can do with, would say, the relative good incomes, and look on not only on expenditure side of your fiscal policy, but look on your income side, because you are still not doing your homework regarding the tax evasion or VAT gap, as was mentioned already here in the last panel. In my view, the external devaluation would be too costly, and I'm afraid that the result would be very, very weak. And why? Because if you look on the graph, we can stay here, the share of export of Greece economy is only 30% on GDP. It's not like in Czech Republic, then you have more than 70%. So the impact of external devaluation would have a very limited impact on the country. And even more, some sectors like oil refinery are already working in US dollars. So income, input and output are priced in US dollars. So any devaluation will not impact the prices of input and outputs of such sectors. So I'm saying the external devaluation, the adoption, new drachma, make more, would say, instability in the Eurozone, and it may make the situation even harder. So the way from darkness, in my view, is combination of internal devaluation with the fiscal stabilization, especially done through fiscal revenues. And this is the main, would say, message that I would like to send here, and I'm happy to hear your opinion or to have another opinion on this topic. Thank you for attention.
Thank you for this very interesting presentation and for good points. Because I have the right to intervene in between the panels, I will do so very shortly on these topics. I am happy that we've heard that the adjustment through external devaluation or even internal can bear really limited results and can cause more instability than of stability. If we look also on the type of trade that Greece or type of exports of Greece, we see that they are complementary, not substitutable to the exports of the rest of the EU. Basically saying that just by making things cheaper or wage cheaper in Greece, not necessarily we will see a revamp in the trade balance. So there is certainly a point in this that is now being to a big extent absorbed by the economist community. You want to talk?
I agree.
Okay. And another thing that I wanted to point out, and it's a very important one also, and being a subject of research in the past 6 years, because there's a lot of research being done on Eurozone in the last 6 years with no real tangible results, but anyway, is that there's not a clear correlation between public debt and fiscal instability, but between external debt, whatever its type, whether it's private or public, it's about the externality of the debt or the fact that somebody else holds the debt and that it's being, in case if you don't have a currency, it really becomes a problem. Otherwise, we don't see in Japan or even in Italy for this or in Belgium the same problems exactly because of a low level of external indebtedness of those countries. And just one small remark on the parallel currency. It is clear that if parallel currency were to be introduced in Greece, in reality the debts would have to be paid in euros, and they, of course, would not be, or they would be actually twice as large as they are today, or both in terms of GDP or in nominal drachma terms. Therefore, it would come back to a debt restructuring, and then why to make a parallel currency, or why to kick out Greece out of the Eurozone if we actually can deal with remaining Greece while having a debt restructuring? Because kicking off Greece temporarily or not, me personally thinking that it's a very uncivilized way to deal with a nation, would not also solve the problems, and we would have to go through the debt restructuring. Of course, it's much more difficult, the question of the debt restructuring, since in 2012 we had a shift from private creditors to the public ones, so now it's not anymore an economic or financial market problem, it's a political problem, and that's much harder to solve, unfortunately. So thank you then for listening for my inter-panel remarks, and now we will give word to His Excellency Ambassador of Greece in Prague. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, why is it worth it listening to the perspective from Greece? First of all, having listened to the former panels, actually an excellent mix, and I would like to thank our host for that, an excellent mix from politicians, thinkers, technical experts. It's obvious that Greece had the privilege to be the first one to enter a storm of crisis that still troubled the European Union. Secondly, because the crisis, the euro crisis, actually had all those elements, economic, social, institutional, that are obvious also in the ensuing crisis. And let me get more specific. You know the history of course, of the financial crisis, the complacency of national governments, international institutions, central banks, including, of course, the at the time Greek authorities, and we reach a point where Greece, with the cooperation of the Eurozone partners, they need to urgently take measures. You heard, we discovered that the Eurozone is incomplete and there is important, actually, problems that haven't been addressed. What are the choices that were made? Two main choices that are actually are still obvious and that still actually obvious not only in the minds but also in the behavior of the electorates. First of all, we make the choice not to deal with the issue in what we call community method, not to use the treaties, the legal instruments we had in hand, but to go outside the treaties, use intergovernmental methods. Secondly, we need the help, we do not rely on our own means, but we also need the help of a third factor, in that case, the IMF. In many ways, and we that came to haunt us and other European partners in the years to come, sometimes decisions were made hastily without consulting the electorate, be it in Greece or in other European countries. And of course, that is history now. We come to today. Today, Greece is in the third, actually, adjustment program. What we have achieved and what is actually very important to say is that through all that turbulent history, we managed to maintain political, social stability and social cohesion, and we are actually awaiting some good statistics, some good growth for the next year, about 2%. What is the basis of this optimism? We have the our usual good contributors in our economy. We have shipping, we have tourism, but we also have some new sectors, technology, energy, that where actually Greek businesses managed to diversify during the crisis. So the crisis also had some good results. It actually underlined the extrovert nature of the Greek businesses. It was coupled with an ongoing effort of improving the Greek public administration, and it brought in a new entrepreneurial spirit in the Greek economy. On the Eurozone level, you heard different options. The fact is that the Eurozone actually looked at the problem. It managed to introduce reforms. These reforms actually are, we all know, still incomplete in the wake of the Five Presidents' Report. Talks of Brexit have definitely subsided. I was actually reading the other day that the bank that, even the bank that coined the term Grexit, has now said that it's not on the cards. It's of course, it's no news to anybody to say that instead of Grexit, now we're dealing with Brexit. So I think it's there are many unknowns, and no actually prediction is for sure. What helped Greece is that we actually had an extensive reform agenda that we managed little by little to remake the economy, and we have some 5-6 elements that also make us more optimistic for the future. The successful completion of the first review, the very productive recapitalization of the systemic Greek banks, the ongoing reforms in the labor market, the fact that the Greek market has swiftly adapted to the new reality of electronic transactions, the new paradigm of extraversion in the Greek business, the commitment of Greece's partner. And finally, let me say that in the next 6 months, it's not only the Eurozone issue, but it's also a host of issues that Greece and the European Union need to actually address, including the migration that we earlier actually spoke of on, in this house. Giefer Hofstadt actually said it very right. First and foremost, it's the issue is political and also geopolitical. Greece's choice to join the euro was political. Being ambassador of Greece to the Czech Republic, although relatively fresh here, it's clear to my mind that the eventual choice of the Czech Republic to join or not the euro will also be political. The economic actually elements are there, they are known. It all depends on the wish both of the Czech Republic and of its partners to further advance in the European integration. This is, of course, as members of the Eurozone and as the sole panelist from a Eurozone country on this panel, this is definitely something that we would heartily wish. On the geopolitical side, I would say that Greece dealing with both the financial and the migration crisis has actually once more inserted in the European debate the value of geopolitics. I think that we've traditionally been a frontline state, that not only asked for solidarity, but also extended solidarity. And that's something that we very much made clear during the latest migration crisis. I think these two elements, solidarity and flexibility, and I also make reference to the State of the Union speech by President Juncker, I think are the main elements that need to stay in our minds when it comes to how European and national institutions work. I think that this is about common problems of the European family. This is about not only playing by the rules, but also using the flexibility embedded in the rules to the benefit of the citizens for addressing issues important to the citizens. I think that theory and dogma had their day. Now we need to look into flexibility. We need to look forward in the aftermath of the Bratislava Declaration, and also on all these issues that southern countries that assembled in Athens ahead of Bratislava pointed out, that is growth, jobs, youth, internal, external security, migration. Let me say that solidarity is mentioned 16 times in the treaty, and it's just simple solidarity, not flexible solidarity. So flexibility and solidarity. Let me say again that having been the first country that entered the eye of the storm, having experienced a fragmentation and an attempted fragmentation of the Union into lenders and borrowers, we are very much justified in saying that united we stand, and that being all a family, Greece actually was a country that voted for the accession of the Eastern European states, including Czech Republic, and I myself was on the enlargement team that actually, on the part of Greece, negotiated the treaty. We're very much justifying in state that we should stick together in turbulent times, and under pressure, we are optimistic that something good may come. Thank you very much.
Thank you for these hopeful words. Just a small personal remark. When I saw the lists of the reform agenda of the three programs, adjustment programs of Greece, every single time I thought of the 12 labors of Hercules, seeing that they seemed impossible, and yet they were done to a large extent that I have not even hoped for. So there is, to a big extent, although we can hear a lot of critique that some policies were not implemented or some adjustment was not complete, I think it was hardly imaginable that as much internal adjustment would really take place in Greece, taking it from the perspective of 2010. Okay, thank you. Now I will ask Ilya if he can contribute to the debate with his input. And I will just warn you that we will have just a very short discussion in the panel, and we will open as soon as possible after Kristen talks for your questions. Thank you. I think you, sorry, you need the microphone because of the interpreters, but thank you.
Thank you, Alice. I'm fascinated by the discussion so far, and thank you very much, Ambassador Eftimiades, for what you had to say. But I think, and obviously, given your job as a diplomat, you are indeed very diplomatic. I mean, I would go much far and further than that by saying that what happened to Greece should have never happened, not only to Greece, but to any other country in Europe. The devastation which was caused to not just the Greek economy and Greek society, but to the Eurozone, which will have very long-lasting effects by national egoisms of a fragmented Europe, in which solidarity is mentioned every single time European leaders are meeting, is only proving to us that, like we have this saying in Bulgaria, the one who talks only about women probably doesn't do much with women. And very much the issue with European solidarity has been proven to be the case of much talk, no deeds whatsoever. And I still am a little puzzled by the fact that we have quite precise diagnosis in Europe, in the Eurozone, on the effects of the disease, but we don't have a holistic diagnosis of what's really causing all those effects. We're quite clear about problems with the construction of the Eurozone. We're quite clear with the political deficits. We're quite clear about the fundamental issue with demographics we have in Europe, because modern economics is not ever being developed to study and be efficient projecting and analyzing economic developments in strongly and completely inverted demographic distributions, which we have today. But we ended up with prescribing not only the wrong medicine, but insisting on the wrong treatment of Greece, because we tried to impose on Greece the dirtiest internal devaluation as a solution to a purely banking sovereign debt problem which initially we had there, which could have been solved, much quickly, much more quickly and much more efficiently if it hadn't been for the combined effect of those three deficiencies in the construction, in the political environment, and in the demographics. And in fact, Greece was basically sentenced to economic coma as early as 2008, when Bundeskanzlerin Merkel, after the Lehman crisis, said that from now on, we will not allow systemic bank to fail, but each country will have to guarantee their own banking system. That's totally impossible. That's the worst example of European populism done for internal party political reasons we have seen for decades, perhaps. I mean, this is more dangerous populism than the populism of people like Le Pen, because it actually creates the fertile environment in which the nationalist populisms are now very well growing on. It's not only to blame it on the Bundeskanzlerin, because the Bundeskanzlerin obviously has to win elections at home and defend the interests of their constituents at home, but it was the complacency of all representatives of each European country, finance ministers, central bankers in Frankfurt as well, some of whom basically were happy to go with that policy because it does serve their national interest. Others were complacent because they were scared that market forces and capital markets will punish them very harshly if they are seen to be weak fiscally or in terms of sovereign debt by confronting the policy which was established in 2008. And thanks God that the efficient markets are not that efficient, so it took them 2.5 years to realize that what was set as a policy in 2008 basically would lead inevitably to the default of Greece. Because for years the Eurozone existed on the assumption that what is denominated in Euro is denominated in Euro. So it's basically like all the other Euro-denominated sovereign bonds. And Greece was lent happily by everyone money in Euro to, you know, their sovereign obligations with the anticipation that, you know, there will never be a failure or default on Euro-denominated government debt, which created enormous problem in the Greek banking system. And a problem like that could never be solved with structural measures as well. The structural measures which were right to be imposed on Greece for the longer term, they were only perhaps able to somehow be a recipe for not letting this happen again in the future, but would never take Greece out of the problem which basically emerged from the fact that the Greece banking system, the Greek banking system and the Greek sovereign debt was totally unprotected in a currency they did not control. And also the other thing was that, I mean, we quite often think out here, disagree slightly with Helena, we quite often think that if Greece wasn't in the Eurozone, that would have not happened to Greece. I doubt that. I think the same thing could have happened perhaps, not perhaps that severely, because Greece would have still be lent that much money in Euro to the bank through the banking system, and it was going to be hedged against, you know, the drachma on the sovereign debt during the good years, and we would have still had the banking problem, which I mean, the bigger countries like Germany and France perhaps were too reluctant to address more aggressively in 2011 because they feared what would be the impact on their banking system at home. And it wasn't that much, even the Greek debt, which had to be immediately restructured and probably priced down to, you know, a very low levels. It was the problem that the not capitalized and not sufficiently prepared banking system of the Eurozone to deal with issue like that had to start selling assets in order to match the regulatory requirements. And if they had to do that, they would have started selling not Greek assets, which were would have been priced close to zero as a result of the restructuring package, but they would have started selling Italian assets and other assets. We should have, you know, if everyone comes to the market at the same time, it destroys basically the valuation and the mark-to-market of all the assets. So, problem with construction, political problem, but we still are failing to address the fundamental problem of the demographics we have in Europe, which is the core reason for the negative rates. It's not the ECB. ECB is only accommodating that, but the massive problem with capital allocation and the impossibility of Germany and export economies, particularly Germany, to have efficient capital allocation at home, are leading to savings which basically could not be used for anything but to fund, again, debt of other sub-economies which are importers to German economy, it continues to be left unattended. And here we have this vision about the empires Verhofstadt spoke about earlier today, with the impossibility of Europe to become a good and efficient empire, because economically we have centered the Eurozone in Europe around Germany. But Germany is an exporter. 47% of the GDP comes from exports. Germany, in situation like that with a currency without fiscal authority, where no fiscal transfers were possible to be done, no such fiscal transfers could be done to Greece in order to deal with the situation like unemployment and depression, Germany naturally acts unintendedly as a black hole, which is basically sucking all the monetary deficits of the other countries, creating huge surpluses at home. And here, we end up with the famous policy which Mario Draghi called Nein zu allem. Let's muddle through slowly until somehow it gets resolved by itself, but it continues not to be resolved by itself because we don't build any new internal mechanisms to accommodate some rebalancing. Actually, Euro has been stable, as previously said, as a currency, but the internal rebalancing has not happened. And to wrap it up, one of the things I've been writing over the last 2-3 years as you know, theoretical proposal of what could be done in order to more quickly get not only Greece but the entire Eurozone and the European Union, because even those who are not in the Eurozone are suffering from the prolonged depression we have in the EU as a result of the Eurozone. What could be done so we can end up more quickly out of the current recession and not repeat it in the foreseeable future, as Aleš also suggested it might happen. And I call this a new Reaganomics for Europe. And a new Reaganomics today, I think, should be politically much more easily promoted than 10 or 15 years ago, because we have existential external threats like the Reagan administration had in the 80s. And they're particularly acute for Europe, not so much about the United States or the other countries. We have the problems with Ukrainian crisis, we have the problems in the Middle East. In Europe, we spoke a lot about defense union today, but the question is how and how quickly. Because even if we go back to Greece, we'll see that one of the structural problems which was so often pointed out as causing massive government spending and hidden deficits, it was the so-called hidden defense budget of Greece. So why does Greece have such a huge defense budget? Obviously, because it was funded during the good years. How was it funded? The exporters of defense were very happy to fund Greek debt because they were basically buying from their national industrial military complexes. But Greece is a frontier country. Greece needs to be much more strong militarily than perhaps the Czech or the Hungarians being in the center of Europe. But Greece cannot do that in the new geopolitical environment with its own resources. So if we implement new Reaganomics for Europe, then it will mean that we start spending on defense from the total European pocket, or, you know, common European pocket and such, and then Greece would not need to spend that much on defense itself if we spend more for defense where the new borders and frontiers of the European Union are, because we still have our defense more or less structured as it was during the border of the Cold War, and that's completely obsolete now. And at the same time, the Americans are telling us, guys, we're sorry, after the war, obviously, we needed to cover you for defense because it was also in our own national interest. But you are 200 million more than us, you've got bigger GDP than us, and you still expect us to pay for your defense. I mean, that's not going to happen. This is not Trump. This is a very reasonable and systemic sentiment which is developing now in the United States. So the momentum is there. We have such a good crisis which we are missing. We are missing to invest into real structural solutions for Europe which can give us even ability to take more quickly a few steps further in the process of creating more federalized Europe. And at the end, I just also was discussing earlier with Christian something which we kind of neglect as a problem in Europe when it comes to the political deficits. And the problem is that each prime minister cares every year about certain election in their country. So when they care so much about the elections in their country every year, that quite often block solutions like banking union, like deposit insurance fund for the Eurozone and things like that, which are difficult to sell at home. In the United States, I mean, they've got elections every 2 years. And if we want to do United States of Europe, we probably should consider how we can reform our electoral system in such a way that actually in Europe, for national parliament, for European parliament, everybody more or less votes at the same time. So every 2 years we vote for 1/3 of European parliament, our national assembly, or whatever else need to be voted. And then we'll eliminate this political mud through which we cannot be muddling through, because it's constantly blocking more responsible solutions for Europe as such, because the national agendas prevail. And with this, I think I took already far too much of the time, so thank you.
Thank you, you did, but it was very interesting, so I accepted that. It's some very interesting topics, but we still need to have intervention from Christian, so please.
Thank you very much. I try to be as fast as possible. So As Ms. Horská said in her presentation, when we talk about the debt crisis, politics is much more important than the economy, so I will focus on the political fallouts of the debt crisis. I would like to raise 2.5 points, two important and a must-have point, but before that I need to apologize in advance from His Excellency, because I will not be very diplomatic with the Greek Prime Minister in my presentation. And also I have to warn the diplomat from the Hungarian embassy that I will not be very polite with our prime minister, so I give you some homework for tonight when you go back to the embassy. So first I would like to talk about the political consequences of the debt crisis. Then I would like to talk about the economic consequences of the political consequences of the debt crisis. And finally, I would like to talk about Russia, which is inevitable these days. The most obvious and visible result of the debt crisis is the rise of populism everywhere in Europe, especially in those countries which were most severely hit by the financial crisis. There are many explanations of this new rise of populism. I would like to mention only two, which are very important for macroeconomists as well. First is distrust, the second is confusion. Distrust. I think it's normal that people don't like bankers, but before it be, and banks, but before the financial crisis, in many countries, the public trust in banks was higher than the trust in the local parliaments. So people somehow trusted the financial institutions, which I always considered some sort of perversion, but this was the way. But after the financial crisis, this trust disappeared, and people don't trust the financial institutions anymore. This is not the end of the world. This is, as I said, normal. But the problem is that this trust spread. The real problem is that distrust spread over to the democratic institutions and democracy itself. So especially in former communist countries, people don't trust democratic institutions and they are disappointed at democracy as a whole. And this is the root, this is the fertile soil of populism. The second, confusion. There is one, at least one benefit of the European Union, because it created an excellent database, which is called Eurobarometer, and it presents us with fantastic figures. I will give you some figures about Greece. There is a question in the Eurobarometer when people ask, globalization is an opportunity for our economy. Agree or disagree? In 2009, 7 years ago, 2009, yes, 7 years ago, in Greece, 50% agreed with this. The EU average was 61%. This year, only 25% of Greek agreed with this, while the EU average was 57. So on EU level, there was a slight reduction of the support for globalization. But in Greece, people turned anti-globalization. And in parallel to this, of course, they demanded more protectionism. One would expect that if people hate globalization, demand more state intervention, they demand more protectionism, they would demand more state intervention. No, it's not the case in Greece. 88%, a historic high, said that they think that the state intervenes too much in their lives. So it's a complete contradiction, and it shows that these nations, especially those which were hit by the debt crisis and the financial crisis, confused. Confusion and distrust are the two main psychological bases for the rise of populism. And it's not a surprise that these societies or these countries created a new breed of politicians, populist politicians. Tsipras in Greece, Iglesias in Spain, Orban in Hungary, just to name the most famous ones, the new ones. And of course, populists have always been present in our in politics, but they gained momentum because of the debt crisis. So this is the reason for the rise of populism. Why is it important for the banking sector? And this is my second point. Because I think populists in power create more instability in the financial sector. I think last week there were news about that in Greece the police raided the office of the company of the wife of the central bank governor. There are allegations that the reason why it happened is that the government, the Tsipras government, want to threaten the central bank governor through this action because they want to get hold of the Attica Bank in Greece. Okay, this is just an allegation. Nobody knows whether it's true or not. But if we take a look at another famous populist in Europe, Mr. Orban, he introduced the bank tax first, which was a just move, by the way. But second, he created four or five totally, fully state-owned banks and acquired further banks in the banking sector. So practically, the government, the prime minister himself, has very strong influence on the bank sector. In addition, the central bank governor of Hungary is completely controlled by the prime minister. So it seems that the populists have an obsession of taking hold of banks in their respective countries. Some say that this is part of the fight for sovereignty, to take back the control over their own countries because the bank sector is usually owned by foreign companies for the former communist countries. It's not the case. When we see a populist, we have to be careful because there is always, populism is always about money. So when a populist gets hold of a bank, he or she will not use this power for the public good. He will use this power for his own private good. So if there are strong positions in the banking sector of populists in Europe, that would create a very further risks for the banking sector in Europe as a whole. So my third point is the Russian influence. Russia is interested in destabilizing Europe in three ways. The first is supporting extremist political parties and extremist radical political movements. My colleagues at Political Capital wrote an excellent book about the connection between Kremlin and the Golden Dawn in Greece. Very few know that the Golden Dawn has very strong connections with the Kremlin. But we can see this beautiful friendship between the Hungary's Jobbik, Front National, the Dutch, the Swedish extremist parties. They all have connections with the Kremlin. The second way Russia is destabilizing Europe is through the propaganda and disinformation. So they spread fake stories through their television channels, websites, and so on and so on. And the third, and this is the most important, is the economic influence. Whether it's the energy sector in Hungary, the property market in Côte d'Azur, or the private bank account of Gerhard Schröder, Russia, though it's financially very weak, it still has power, economic power to influence Europe. And of course, since Russia is interested in destabilizing Europe, we can imagine how it would affect, how it can deepen a crisis, a further crisis, if it happens in Europe. So I hope, okay, I stop it here, so the questions.
Thank you very much. Taken in line, all those speeches, I think, would make for a good paper, transcribed maybe even word by word. I think that it made sense that we let everybody finish their presentations and say what they wanted, as altogether I think it really gave a good picture of the situation that we found ourselves in. Nevertheless, and I will not allow myself any other comments, although I would have many, I would like to take some questions from the public, unless the panelists would like to address some burning topics of the other panelists. Let's open it for the public then. So first question, yes?
Charles Ross, European Anti-Corruption Center. Thank you very kindly to our distinguished panelists. I'd like to follow up from your last comments about the influence of the Russian government on the European financial sector. As we saw in section 2 of the Yeltsin Doctrine, which very briefly was public and then was classified by President Vladimir Putin in his first days in office, We see a long-term plan to penetrate European banking, and of course, with the disinformation program that we have seen accompanying the Russian hybrid invasion of Ukraine, we see very serious economic impacts, and not just in the energy sector, of course. Citing with reference Maastricht University's landmark study on that issue. I'd like to hear your thoughts on where we are going in cleaning up this mess, because indeed, it is quite complicated, and I think that the results of the State Duma elections this weekend and Mrs. Merkel's unfortunate lack of success in yesterday's elections is an indicator of some problems that still need to be addressed. Thank you very kindly.
Thanks for this intervention. I will try to collect more questions so that we answer together, but this one will go for Christian. For sure, I mean, external destabilization of the functioning of the market institutions in Europe is a topic, a recent one and an important one.
I would like to follow up what was said by Ms. Helena Horská. Well, we have two countries in Europe that are currently in very deep troubles. It's Greece and Ukraine. My question would be why the EU is not doing something against that some countries use incentives to attract industries, like, for example, in Slovakia already the third or fourth car producer is coming, and Slovakia has no labor for this, so it has to import from Mongolia and other places. Why we don't have in EU some policies, some incentives directing producers, industrial producers to those countries which are in crisis, so that they can improve the trade balance of those countries and improve the tax collection in those countries that could help them, leading them out of debt. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That was an interesting point on how to solve some of the issues that we're dealing with today. If there is anybody else who would have a question, so I will leave Christian first to answer Charles's question on the influence of Russia, basically, on the banking sector.
Well, I'm very pessimistic, and not just because I'm Hungarian, because I think the situation is very, very worrying. 4 years ago, I had a dinner with the foreign minister of a big country, and when I asked him that why is it that they let Orbán do what he's doing, and he said that Orbán is your problem, deal with it. You chose him, deal with it. And I said, no, it's contagious. Believe me, it won't stop in Hungary. Then 2 years ago, I had a meeting with a German official, and I said that, don't you see that what the Russians are doing with the far right in Germany? It's marginal, nothing will happen. And this spring, I participated in a conference where high-level EU diplomats were talking about the future of Europe, and the most important topic was how the European Union can cope with the challenges of globalization. So I think people, the mainstream politicians don't understand the scale of the Russian influence. They don't understand the importance and don't understand how deep it is now everywhere in Europe. And I think this is the most dangerous threat for the European Union right now.
Thank you. Concerning the question on redistribution of basically investment activities across Europe in order to sustain some countries in crisis, does anybody have a comment on this?
Helena?
Yeah.
If I may,
Sorry. of course, this is, I think, the common problem of common policies. There is lack of common policy, a common approach to many things, including taxes, including the common policy for interaction of FDI. But the first thing is that, as you maybe know, all the incentives for FDI should come to be agreed with the European institution. So every country has to send, ask to, I would say, be agreed in European countries and institution. But the general point that I would like to stress here, this is only the part of the problem that in EU level we are, would say, missing the common approach to many and many areas, including FDIs.
Thank you. That would make for a topic for another panel at the end. But I'll leave Ilya to react also.
Very quickly. Aleš, thank you very much. I'm very puzzled by this issue and in a way a little skeptical even how we approach it, because there are not only structural problems related to it, like we have not cleaned up the banking system of the Eurozone. We are kicking the can down the road 7 years now. Until now we realize that the German banks are zombie banks as any other banks, and maybe Deutsche Bank, as IMF wrote not too long ago, is the most dangerous bank in the world. I mean, it's operating at leverage above 40 times. So it's basically, you know, a very highly leveraged hedge fund, which can rely only on the German government to bail it out if needed. So as a result of the problem coming back to Germany and impacting now their export prospects, we see change in Dr. Schäuble's and, you know, the German Orthodox economist vision of how to address the issue. But we also have, apart from the structural issue, we have a fundamental issue. We have demographics in Europe, across Europe, which looks like an onion. I mean, economics doesn't know how to deal with that issue. That's why people like, you know, Nobel laureate Stiglitz and others say, I mean, economics, as we've known it, doesn't work anymore. Basically, the economics is developed to work in an environment in which your demographic distributions look like Egyptian pyramid or like a ziggurat. But now the distribution in Germany and in other countries looks more like the building of the Slovak radio in Bratislava, which is an inverted pyramid. And actually, this is communist legacy, the inverted pyramid. And if you look in the demographics of the post-communist country, you see how deeply impacted we are today as well. So the solidarity, how can solidarity work here? I mean, the issue which Mario Draghi has been banging on about, which is quite peculiar that the central banker dares to talk about this, is the fiscal side of the equation. All right, we don't have yet fiscal authority, we probably won't have it anytime soon, but what we can do and what Mario Draghi has been suggesting is that the ministers of finance, the ECOFIN members can agree on supply side measures as quickly as possible. We didn't ever have austerity. We called austerity a program for dirty internal devaluation. And that's usually extremely painful. Not only Greece suffered, other countries in the Eurozone, like Finland, like Spain, like Ireland, it wasn't only southern countries which really suffered from this wrong policy. And the Reaganomics was very heavily based on the supply side measures at the time, because you need to somehow motivate those who will create the added value and the productivity and the investment, who are the entrepreneurs, to start taking more risk. It will never happen until we clean up the banking system, because unlike in the United States, we don't have capital markets to have a second transmission mechanism. And before we embark on supply side measures, making Europe more liberal, reducing all this, you know, Brussels bureaucracy on regulations and things like that, but also see where tax rates could be brought down rather than, you know, put up like it was in the case of Greece, and spend more on defense, because we've seen how much the cohesion program has failed to lead to convergence. We need to start spending common European funds on high tech, on highly value-added industries, which perhaps could be best driven by a more rational and geared up to the new geopolitical realities defense investment. Thank you.
Thank you, Ilya. Now, another short intervention from Zdeněk, and then I'll try to conclude.
Just a few last sentences on this question of what can be done to manage the proliferation of Russian influence in the European banking. Well, we've seen on the case of Cyprus what it's like if you let your financial system to be misused and how painful it can be in the end. It's also an example of a strategy of divide and rule, that if the Russian interests are able to carve out one of the smaller banking sectors, be it Latvian, be it Cypriot, then it's much more difficult to manage. So the rational strategy to counter that would be for countries, even those countries who are not in the Eurozone, to join the banking union, because that pools the oversight over the banks. It prevents that powerful third-party interest can get too deeply rooted in the system and breach the regulatory as well as anti-terrorist and anti-money laundering measures. So we have to insist on this common European framework, which actually corresponds to the global regulatory framework, and that's the way to prevent the divide-and-rule approach.
Well, thank you. We could continue basically forever, and myself personally, I continue for the last 6 years. I do remember what I did on the 2nd of May 2010 when there was the first bailout for Greece, almost hour by hour. So we could really discuss long time, and we will have probably and unfortunately many opportunities to discuss the issues related to the Eurozone. Well, thanks a lot to all the panelists. I think you were great. And really, if we put all the words that were said today on a paper, it could be a nice chapter in a handbook on Eurozone. Thank you.